Thank you, Richard and John, for all that information about the Congo. The reason that there's a problem with the, in addition to what Richard said, with the schooling is that the state is finances the schooling, and they don't pay the teachers. So they don't have the money to pay them, and so the teachers are teaching without getting paid, so quite often they don't show up. And the education is pathetic because of that, and the teachers, their hearts are not into it because they're just going through the motions, and that's one of the reasons for why we need the private school. And the other issue that I thought of when Richard was talking is that so many of the children don't have parents. In order for Dan and Tom and myself to go there, we have to get yellow fever shots and typhoid fever and take malaria pills while we're there, because these sicknesses and diseases are still very much alive, as well as the AIDS epidemic has had a tremendous impact on the society. So somebody like Kennedy's brother, who he's very well-to-do compared to so many of the other people, he's a doctor. Him and his wife, I think they have maybe four children of their own. He asked me after a very long meeting, he asked me if I would meet with his family and in his living room, and everybody was gone. I go and I enter, and there's probably 13, 14 kids there. I said through the translator, I thought I was just meeting with his family. He had adopted all the rest of these kids because they didn't have parents. And so many of them had physical problems, so we prayed for a lot of them. We're going to look at John chapter 14 today, and we're going to talk about the enabler, or being enabled. In John 14, blessed that John and Mary McCabe are here from Long Island. It's wonderful to have them. And I'm blessed everybody else is here too, but you know. John owes me a couple of dollars, and if I want to get it back, I've got to be nice. No, that's not true. John 14, the words of our Lord, striking words, shocking words, when he says in verse 12, "Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father." You know, it would be nice for you to follow along is if you took your program out and looked at the questions that I ask, and you can fill them out. The first question that I ask is, what is the greatest work of Jesus, the greatest work Jesus did? You could circle one. Was it healing the leper? Was it healing the blind? Was it raising the dead? Was it walking on water? Feeding the multitudes? Teaching the gospel? Was it one of these, or was it something else? He healed a person that was blind and from birth. Nobody had ever done that before. He raised a number of people from the dead, that one boy that was being carried. That's one of the things they do in the Congo when they have, when someone dies, they carry the casket through the streets. And six guys or a bunch of guys are carrying it. And that's what this was going on. Somebody was carrying, they were carrying the child or the man that had died, the young man that had died. And they were walking through the streets, and Jesus went up and healed him. That was quite a miracle. He healed Lazarus, or he didn't heal him. He raised him from the dead. I guess he healed him too, right? And then there's Lazarus, who was dead for 4 days, and Jesus raised him from the dead. So what was the greatest of the works that Jesus did? You could just circle one, whichever one you think. Because this is important to us, because it says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these, because I go unto my Father." Well, does that mean that we can do those same works that he did? Are we to think that he meant that we too can turn water into wine, that we can heal lepers, that we can give sight to the blind, that we can feed the multitudes, which he did twice? Does it mean that we too can walk on water, that we can raise the dead, that we can calm the sea? And all the other mighty miracles that Jesus did? I think many people believe and teach that we have the authority to do these things in Christ Jesus. Based upon this verse and other verses, like the verse in Matthew 21:21, which says, "Truly I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what was done to the fig tree, but even if you say to this mountain, be taken up and cast into the sea, it will happen." And so I think that there is a teaching, I've taught it and I've believed it at one point in my life, and I think a lot of people teach it, that we can do these things. The thought is we are followers of Christ, we have His authority and permission to do all these things, and the only thing that holds us back is our faith. The significant problem with this is that I don't know anyone that has done all of these things apart from Jesus Christ. I don't know of any mountain that has been cast into the sea. I've never heard of that happening. For that matter, most people who try to do these type of things fail miserably. And the terrible ramifications of this failing is they are left to wonder if there was something wrong with their faith, or is there something wrong with God? Neither of those thoughts are necessarily encouraging, to say the least. So why did Jesus say to us, "The works that I do, you can do also, and greater than these"? Let's look at, keep your marker there. Well, it wouldn't be too hard to find. And we're going to go to chapter 5. Even if you don't keep your marker there, I'm very confident that you could find your way back to chapter 14. In John chapter 5, in verse 17, "And Jesus said to them, 'My Father is working until now, and I myself am working.'" God is at work in the world until now, and now that I am here, I too am working. Verse 19, Jesus answered and said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of himself, unless it is something he sees the Father doing. For whatever the Father does, these things the Son does also in like manner. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all things that he himself is doing, and the Father will show him greater works than these, so that you will marvel." And then I didn't put in your notes and should have, verse 30. You can add that to your notes. Verse 30. "I can do nothing on my own initiative." I can do nothing on my own initiative. "As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just, because I do not seek my own will, but the will of him who sent me." Now back to John 14. So the works that Jesus did, all of the works that Jesus did, were the works that God told him to do. In John 14, in the context of that verse 12, look at verse 9. "And Jesus said to Philip," here, "Have I been so long with you, and yet you have not come to know me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe," verse 10, "that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own," what? "My own initiative, but the Father abiding in me, he does the works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, otherwise believe me because of the works themselves." What he's saying very clearly is, the works that I do are not my works. They're the Father's works. And the words that I speak are not my words, but the Father's words. In other words, God told him what he wanted him to do. Jesus had a sensitivity to God. He knew what God's will was in each situation. So when Jesus passed by the blind man and saw that he was blind, it was then at that point that he either asked God or God told him, "You can heal that blind man. I want you to heal that blind man, and here's how I want you to do it. Bend over, spit on the ground, make clay out of the spittle and put it on his eyes, tell him to go wash in the pool of Siloam." That wasn't Jesus' initiative. He didn't say, "There's a blind guy, I'm going to go heal him." No, that's not how it worked. God said, there's a blind guy, I want you to go heal him. Jesus didn't just randomly raise people from the dead. There was a lot of dead people. Why did he raise these two from the dead that I'd made mention of? Because God told them to. God had a purpose for everything that was done. One of the great purposes was so that the world would know that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. That there'd be no doubt about that. The other was he had an eternal purpose. He had a purpose, he says, of the ages that he had in mind. We won't talk about that this morning, but the point is that Jesus didn't randomly decide what he was going to do. Rather, God told him, he listened and saw where God was at work, and then did what God told him to do. So I say to you, what is the greatest work that Jesus did? Of all the things that Jesus did, what was the greatest of the works that he did? Well, I have it in your notes. He always knowing the will of God. He always knew the will of God. He knew the will of God because he studied the Bible. He knew what the Bible said, that this is the word of God, the will of God is connected to the word of God. When you read the word of God, it is the will of God. So he knew the word of God, and in any given situation, he would ask God, or God would tell him, and he had the sensitivity to hear what God wanted done, and then therefore he did it. So Jesus, these three great works are what Jesus did. Always knowing the will of God, always obeying God, and always speaking what God wanted spoken. That's the third thing. You fill in the line there. He always spoke what God wanted spoken. In other words, Jesus depended upon God's leading in everything. So the works that he did, the greatest of the works that he did, the leper or the blind or the deaf or all of these individual miracles, really they were the manifestation of the one great work in which he did was to know the will of God and to carry out the will of God. The works that I do, you can do also, and greater, we'll talk about that in a minute. Those works, the great work that Jesus did was knowing the will of God, and then doing the will of God, and then speaking the will of God. And there isn't anyone that is his that can't do that. Now, it may very well be that in the process of your walk with God, he may say to you, heal that blind man. And I want you to do it this way. He might say to you, raise that person from the dead. And you know, anything that God says to you to do, you already have the authority in Christ to do it. There has never been, and I mentioned this last week, that God doesn't play games with us. If he commands us to do something, we have the ability to do it. If he commands us to not do something, we have the ability to do it. If you have the ability, then you have the authority. It's the same thing when you're walking through life and if God should say to you, I want you to pray for this person that their particular problem will be resolved, and you do it as he tells you to do it, and that you pray and then it will be done because God told you to do it. It will always work because God backs up his own word. Now, you're walking through life and you decide that you see somebody that's sick and you run up and say, well, I'm going to minister healing to this guy. Did God tell you to do that? That's why so many times when you tried to do it, it didn't work. You were just doing what you wanted to do. And it doesn't work that way. God doesn't come back and support you in what you decide to do. That's not the way Christianity works. The way Christianity works is what does God want done? He tells us what to do, where he's at work in the world, and we join in him. And then not only does we don't heal people, he does. We just do what he tells us to do in relationship to allowing him to do the work that's in the world. You get the difference?
Yes.
It's a big difference. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 12. No. Did you go? Come back. Come back to where you were. Don't go away. Back to John 14. Verse 12 again. Truly, truly, I say to you, he that believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to the Father. Well, that obvious question would be, well, what greater work could we do than that Jesus did? Well, Jesus couldn't tell people, He couldn't tell people what was about to happen and what it would accomplish. You know, his dying on the cross, God raising him from the dead, his ascending into heaven, and all of the significance that would be accomplished in that act. Jesus could not tell them about that then because it was a mystery. We have the ability to understand these things now. Remember, Jesus said right in this teaching here in John, Jesus said, I have many more things to say to you, but now is not the time. But when the Spirit of truth comes, he will lead you into the all truth. Now we understand what happened on the cross, why Jesus died, for the forgiveness of our sins, for the new covenant to be cut, for the lifestyle that we now have. This is the greater work that we can do, is to teach people about that and also to experience it in our own lives. That wasn't available at that time. It wasn't until he ascended. Now look at verse 14. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper, and he may be with you forever. That is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it does not see him or know him. But you know him because he abides in you and you abide in him. He said, I ask of me and I will give to you. And that Spirit will come and the Spirit will enable you. The Spirit is the great enabler. The Spirit itself, the Holy Spirit, is the thing that enables us to live this godly life. Now look at Luke. Matthew, Mark, Luke. I have a grandson named Luke. Luke chapter 11. He's at my house right now. Luke chapter 11. Hi, Luke. Luke 11. So I say to you, this is a chapter on prayer. So I say to you, ask and it will be given you. Seek and you will find. Luke 11, 9. Seek and knock and it will be open to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be open. Now suppose one of you fathers is asked by his son for a fish. Will he give him a snake instead of a fish? Will he? I know that some of us have had pretty not so good fathers, but this is really a low-life father. You ask him for a fish and he gives you a snake? I don't think so. That's not going to happen. Or if he asks you an egg, will you give him a scorpion? No, you wouldn't do that, would you? If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? If you ask God for the Holy Spirit, he's not going to give you a serpent or a snake or a scorpion. He's going to give you the Holy Spirit. He would not withhold from you this. If you accept the Lordship of Jesus Christ and you're on board with what the Scriptures teaches about all of this, you're ready to have him be your Lord, well, you should very well expect that God would give you the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, I'm going to send the Spirit to you. And that Spirit enables us in so many ways. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 talks about some of the ways that the Spirit enables us so that we can do the works that Jesus did. In 1 Corinthians 12, so what enables you to obey? The Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, in verse 1, it says, now concerning spiritual gifts, you see that right there? You with me? Spiritual gifts. You'll notice that the word gifts is in italics. And that means it was added by the translators. It wasn't in the original manuscripts. Anytime there's italics in the King James or any of the English Bibles, those italics are to indicate to you that they were added in translation. And this is one of those places that it really doesn't help the translation. It kind of confuses it. Well, actually, it doesn't. It's the preachers that have preached it that have confused it. Now concerning spiritual. And it's really, the Greek word is pneumatikos, it's spiritual matters. Now concerning spiritual matters, brethren, I do not want you to be unaware. King James says, I don't want you to be ignorant. You know that when you were pagans, you were led astray to mute idols. However, you were led. You can never go any further than you're led, and that's what they believed in Corinth. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God says Jesus is accursed. If someone is cursing Jesus, is putting Jesus down, speaking badly about Jesus, you can be well assured that they're not speaking by the Spirit of God. That would imply that God, through the Spirit, is telling you to curse Jesus. Do you think God is ever going to do that?
No.
I think not. So if anybody is telling you that they're speaking on behalf of God, but they're cursing Jesus, no, you can't do that, Vince. You can't say that. You can't say, but there's a thing you can... Don't listen to him. You don't want to say bad things to him. I had a woman that gestured at me just the other day and when I was driving. Right near your house. And she, after she went by, I realized she wasn't waving at me. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God says Jesus is accursed, and no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Well, any nincompoop can say that Jesus is Lord. Anyone that can talk, that is. But to really say that Jesus is Lord, you have to have the Holy Spirit. I mean, in other words, for Jesus to be your Lord, you have to have the Holy Spirit. Because it's the Holy Spirit that enables you to obey Jesus. It's the Holy Spirit, it's the gift of Holy Spirit that enables you to walk with Jesus and to understand. If you don't have the Holy Spirit, then you really can't say that Jesus is Lord. You can say the words, but it's not going to be true. You know, you can say, well, I'm a frog. That doesn't make you a frog. Now, verse 4. Now, there are a variety of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are varieties of ministries and the same Lord, and there are varieties of effects, but it's the same God who works all things in all persons. But each one is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. The manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. It's kind of, to explain this to you, it's kind of what I just explained about Jesus, you know, the blind, healing the blind, the lame, raising the dead. Those were all evidences of him being obedient to God. He was doing the works of God. All of those things were the works of God. Okay, so they were sort of manifestations of the works of God. What this is saying is there are manifestations to the gift of Holy Spirit that we've been given. We've all been given, likewise, with Jesus as your Lord, you have the Holy Spirit. If you have the Holy Spirit, there are a number of evidences or manifestations, things you can do because you have the Spirit. If you have a pencil, you can then write with the pencil. And if you have an eraser, you can erase with the pencil. And you can bang it on it. There's a lot of things you can do with a pencil. You can clean your ear. You know, there's a lot of things you can do with a pencil. When you have the Holy Spirit, there are a number of things that are listed here. I don't think it's an all-inclusive list. I think there's more things that can be done. But it gives you an idea of some of the things that we have that we can do. Verse 8, for to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge according to the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing, by the one Spirit, and to another the effects of miracles, and to another prophecy, and to another the distinguishing of tongues, and to another various kinds of tongues, and to another the interpretation of tongues. But one and the self same Spirit works all of these things, distributing to each one individually just as he wills. The point is that there's one Spirit. Everybody has the same Spirit. You know, none of us got, you know, Frank didn't get a different spirit than Dina, and Dina didn't get a different spirit than me. And, you know, we all have the same Spirit. And there are these manifestations of the Spirit that are common to all of us if you got the Spirit. It's a matter of whether you use it or not. You utilize it. Now look at the first one up was wisdom. We're going to go back and forth to this chapter, so you want to keep your ribbon here. Go to James chapter 1, just for an example. We looked last week at Jesus' ability to love rightly in every situation. I mean, sometimes he would hug people and embrace people. Sometimes he would say to them, "Get thee behind me, Satan." Sometimes he would say, "You hypocrites, woe unto you hypocrites." Sometimes he turned over the money table. You know, sometimes he healed people and all the other. How did he know each time what to do in each situation? He was given the wisdom from God. He loved in each of these situations, but the right way to love, you need the wisdom of God. You need God's help to do it right. If you've been around for any length of time, you've loved somebody the wrong way. And more than likely, you've loved somebody the right way. In James chapter 1, the Spirit gives us the ability to have wisdom. Verse 5, "If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all generously and without reproach, and it will be given to him." Now, I know that none of you are lacking wisdom, but probably you know somebody that is. Okay, so this is for them. So, "If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all generously and without reproach." He's not going to give you a hard time because you ask for wisdom. Obviously, I was being sarcastic. We all need wisdom. And it's a result of the manifestation. It's a part of, we have the Holy Spirit, and a part of that is the gifting to say to God, "I need wisdom." And then God then providing you that wisdom. Through the Spirit of God, He will tell you what to do in any given situation where you need His help. That's the Spirit of wisdom. We were talking earlier about Richard talking about the Congo. And 35 years ago, it might have been longer than that now, a while back. First time I went to the Congo, things were much different than they are today. There was hardly any Christianity at all at that time. And Kennedy, who is now the person that's the coordinator of the ministry, he was a young boy. He was just a little boy. And he was one among 21 children. And his father came to me, and the Christianity had got there before I was there. But, I came afterwards. There was somebody that was already there. And the father came to me, Kennedy's father came to me for counseling. And he said to me, "I don't know what to do. I read in the scriptures that you're supposed to be the husband of one wife. I have two wives, and I have 21 children. You know, about half and half, 10 from this and 11 from that. So I have two wives. Should I divorce one of my wives and just stay with the other one?" I thought to myself, "What am I doing here?" No. I asked God. I had no idea how to answer that. I asked God for wisdom. I said to Him, "God's honest truth, don't get any more wives. You know, raise your children and take care of these two women." This is what I told him. Now, about 5 or 6 years ago, he came to, now this is 5 or 6 years later, he raised all of these kids, and him and his two wives came to me for marriage counseling. And I'm not going to tell you that, but again, I needed wisdom. And where did that wisdom come from? Vince doesn't have that in his back pocket. God does. God knows what to do. And because we have the Spirit, we can ask for wisdom, and God can provide it where we need it. Look at, again, 1 Corinthians 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Ethan and Kim are going to get married this week, so we're going to have some marriage counseling after this. It's going to be a lot easier. Yeah, you can clap. That's good. This is Ethan's last free week and Kim's last free week. So, then life is going to get better starting Thursday. So, but I don't expect you to come back in 30 years with us two wives. So, where are we? Verse 12. It's not where I want to be. Verse 8, for everyone is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, and to another the word of knowledge according to the same Spirit. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 2. So another part of another manifestation of the Spirit is knowledge. You can read the Bible. Anybody can read the Bible. Anybody can read and understand the words that are written. Anybody can read and understand the God that it talks about and the stories that it tells and the Messiah that it speaks about. But to really understand it, you have to have the Spirit. It says in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, in verse 12, yeah. Now, we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, so that we may know the things freely given to us by God. Which things also we speak not in words taught by human wisdom. Paul saying, that which I speak to you, I'm not doing this of my own. This is God's words I'm speaking to you. God told them what to speak. But in those taught by the Spirit, combining spiritual thoughts with spiritual words. Now everybody pay attention. Verse 14. I want everybody to listen. But the natural man does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him. He cannot understand them because they are spiritually appraised or spiritually discerned. The natural man would be a man that or a woman that does not have the Spirit of God. They cannot understand the things of God, which are written in the Scripture. They can't understand it like you can understand it if you do have the Spirit of God. It is the Spirit of God that gives you the ability to receive and understand the knowledge of God. You get what I'm saying? Again, verse 14. Now again, pay attention. But the natural man, that's the guy that doesn't have the Spirit, does not accept the things of the Spirit of God. He doesn't accept them. He doesn't believe them. He doesn't understand them. For they are foolishness to him. He just really doesn't get it. And he cannot understand them because they are what? Spiritually appraised. Now, what I'd like for everybody here to do, you all heard me what I just said, right? What I'd like for you to do is to turn to the person sitting next to you and tell them in a line what you just understood from what we just looked at. What did you just, very quickly, you know, one person tell the other person, then the other person tell back. That shouldn't take that long, for goodness sakes. I mean... So, did the person you talked to understand?
Yes.
He or she did? Right? If you didn't understand, if you didn't understand that verse, which is a possibility, then you need to get the Spirit. And the way to get the Spirit is to have the Lord Jesus Christ understand that and to gain an understanding of Jesus as your Lord and start living that way. Then you'll get the Spirit and then you can understand it. But all the rest of you that understood that, the reason you understood it is because you just operated one of the manifestations of the Spirit. It's the Spirit that helps you to understand. That's the only way you could possibly understand that. The natural man reads this and it's foolishness to him. What are you talking about? It doesn't make any sense to me. If you've got the Spirit of God, it makes a lot of sense to you. Okay? And that's the way it goes with reading the Bible, and also as God would speak to you in your life. Now go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. The Spirit was given so that we would have these manifestations in our life. I don't think there's any, You know, wrong teaching is that there's a distinction that some people get wisdom and some people get knowledge. Who do you know that doesn't need wisdom? Who do you know that doesn't need the knowledge of God? I mean, he ascended. There's nobody like that. And even he needed it. So everybody needs it. Everybody, these manifestations are for the whole church. Verse 12, verse 8. For everyone is given the word of the Spirit through the, given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, and another the word of knowledge according to the Spirit, and to another faith by the same Spirit. The very fact that you've got faith in God is a part of this gifting of the Holy Spirit to you. And to another the gifts of healing by the one Spirit, and to another the effects of miracles, and to another prophecy. You can heal people. You can do miracles. By all means, it's a part of the manifestation of the Spirit. It's just that you can't be the one that decides what miracles are done. You're not the one that decides who gets healed. Jesus didn't decide. I love that one in John chapter 5 when he goes to the pool and there's a multitude of sick people there. He goes up to one specific guy and he ministers healing to him. Why that guy over everybody else that was there? Because that's the guy that God told him to do it to. End of story. You can do these things because, but you got to, you know, God's got to be the one telling you to do it. That's not true with all these manifestations. God's already told us if you lack wisdom, ask for it. Okay, obviously we lack wisdom. And if you want knowledge, ask for it. He doesn't say that necessarily with miracles and gifts of healing. That it's gifts. It's a, each time somebody gets healed, it's a gift. And God decides when he wants to give that gift to people. Verse 10 says, and to another the effects of miracles, and to another prophecy, and to another one distinguishing of spirits, that's discerning of spirits, and to another various kinds of tongues, and to another the interpretation of tongues. Now I know that there are some, I speak in tongues because I believe that God wants me to speak in tongues. It says in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, there's quite a bit of information about speaking in tongues. It says, I would that you all spoke in tongues. In Acts chapter 2, on the day of Pentecost, when they first received the Holy Spirit, they were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak in tongues. It says in Acts chapter 10, when Peter brought the word of God to the household of Cornelius, as he's speaking, the Spirit fell on them, and they all started to speak in tongues. In Acts chapter 9, when Paul went to Ephesus, and he talks to these people who were the disciples of John, he starts telling them about Christ and leading them to Christ, and then they spoke in tongues. Speaking in tongues was very common for those that had the Spirit. But then there's some today that will say, well, you know, speaking in tongues is, you know, that went out with the apostles. You want to get rid of speaking in tongues? If you're going to get rid of speaking in tongues, you got to get rid of wisdom too. They're all connected. You got to get rid of knowledge too. And while you're cutting things out, throw out chapter 13 because that's the one that talks about love. And then chapter 14 talks about tongues. Chapter 12 talks about tongues. But if you're going to cut tongues out, then cut out the love too. Then we don't have to love each other anymore. Well, you know, speaking in tongues isn't for everybody. I don't think I can. Shut up. Don't let your mind tell you that. You can speak in tongues. You know why you can't? You know why you haven't spoken in tongues? Because you didn't want to. You didn't make up your mind to do it. You think it's a special gifting that only holy people? John speaks in tongues. Anybody can do it. Wait a minute, that didn't sound right. Because it's not about works. It's not about earning it. It's not about deserving it. Who among us deserves wisdom? Who among us deserves knowledge? Who among us deserves... And that's not the point. You're thinking about it the wrong way. It's a manifestation of the Spirit. I was taught that this is something that I could do. Why wouldn't I be able to do it? They did it in Acts chapter 2. They did it in Acts chapter 10. They did it in Acts chapter 19. Paul said, I speak in tongues more than you all at Corinth. Paul spoke in tongues. And then he says, I would that you all spoke in tongues. So I wasn't a very astute Christian at the time that somebody said this to me. I barely understood where the books. I didn't understand the books of the Bible. I thought Job was talking about where you get jobs. I mean, I didn't know very much of anything at the time. But I believed that I could speak in tongues. So I did. And you can too. Any one of us can. Because we've been given the Spirit of God. And if you got the Spirit of God, then you can operate these manifestations of the Holy Spirit. We can do the works that Jesus did and more because we have been given the gift of Holy Spirit. We've got the enabler. The greater works that we can do is to obey God, God's will, and thereby evidence our love for Him. You've got the ability, and if you've got the ability, you've got the authority. What's going on here? Okay, they're going to do a song? Huh? Yeah. Okay. So, in conclusion, we've been given the ability, and indeed, we can do the works that Jesus did. And some of these things, we don't even need to ask God. You know why? Because it's written in the Scriptures. If Scriptures tell us these are things that we can do. If it's something that we're told that we can do or that we should do, there's no argument. You automatically have the ability and the authority to do it. The things, but as far as wisdom and knowledge and all of these other things, miracles and gifts of healing, as we ask God, and if He wants us to do this, if He wants us to know, He'll help us. If He wants us to do it, He'll tell us exactly what to do. We got the Holy Spirit, we can do it. So Heavenly Father, I thank You for making us equipped in Christ and for giving us this great gift of Holy Spirit. We love You and we are so thankful to You for all that You do for us. And Lord, this week that's gone by, it's been a great one. And thank You for the one that's coming up. We ask that You would be with us hand in hand and that we can be more mindful than ever of the great enablements that are ours with the Holy Spirit. That we can seek of You when we need wisdom and when we need knowledge and when we need the manifestations of miracles and so on. Father, we thank You so much for your continual concern for our well-being. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Amen.